Hey everybody, it is time to hop into James. We took 2 days off. Maybe some of you guys could get caught up that way. We shot a music video for a song called Courageous that's on our new album and is also a part of a movie called Courageous coming up really soon. Can't wait to talk to you guys more about that. Maybe we'll play a little bit of it in one of our new Bible studies. That would be awesome. I might get in trouble for that. Let's definitely do it. Okay, let's look at chapter 2. We dug into some pretty heavy stuff. We talked about how the Jews in this church, these believers, although they were believers and had Jesus in them and they're walking with God, they brought a lot of the world into church with them, like we all do, okay? They had baggage, and that baggage was coming out in them, and the big thing of the day was the poor were down here and the rich were up here, a lot like it is now. It got so bad that several years later, there was war because of this issue, and he got into them, and he was saying, guys, you're writing people off. You're assuming people's internal value on external situations. And the poor people have faith that you need to grow from. The rich people need to humble themselves and become servants. And we need to even this out and understand at the foot of the cross, the ground is level. There's no high and low. We're all just lost people that are saved. We're all dead men that are risen. And we're all in the same boat. He continues this in verse 8. A lot of times you see a new chapter number or a new paragraph, we think, oh, it's a whole new section, you know. But they didn't have those when they wrote this. Those were all added later. This is just a letter, okay? So on the heels of talking about this situation, how guys, you're saying you're doing this, but you're also doing this. Let's look at verse 8. If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, which says, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you're doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin, and you are convicted by the law as transgressors. Now, right here, they had to be thinking, oh, no, you don't understand. We're the believers. We're the church. We're the good guys. Look at all this good stuff we're doing. You know, we give, we tithe, we sing, we teach classes, we set up the chairs on Sunday morning, and he's bringing some things into perspective for them. He says, for whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. For he who has said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not commit murder. If you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. He's saying this, guys. Look, we hang a piano over your head right now, and we use 10 big links of chain to hang it over your head. Which one of those links has got to break for that thing to fall on you and crush you? Any of them. Once one link's broken, the piano's coming down, my friend. And because we think that because we haven't done this, we're okay. But he's leveling some things out, right? He's saying, look, if you sin, you're a sinner. If you break the law, you're a lawbreaker. Look what he says after this. He says, so speak and act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. You know, I can only tell you about me. I have told you I will be the biggest dork in heaven. If there is a way to mess this thing up, I've cracked the code, okay? And one of the areas that I've always found myself in is, you know, we have our little areas where we've sort of given these things to Jesus, you know? I've given my finances to God, or I've given my temper to God. I've given my this. I've given my that. And we have victory in that area. And we feel good about that victory, sometimes so good that we will sort of forget about the other things that need to be worked on. It's like we take our lives as Christians and we take our days and our hours, our priorities, and we have all these little drawers for each one, right? And this is my Sunday drawer. We pull out that Sunday drawer. Man, my hands are in the air. I'm singing all the songs. I welcome people. I call everybody brother. It's awesome, okay? And then Sunday is over, and we shut that drawer, and we pull out Monday. And when Jesus tries to step into our Monday, we have a problem with that. Yeah? That's what the problem the Pharisees had. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, the ruling order of the day when Jesus walked the earth, as a man, he stepped into their drawers, okay? He walked into their situation, and he started pulling out things, going, what about this? What about this? What about this? And they were thinking, no, this is not how we do church. This lives here, this lives here. This is how we roll. And they killed him for it. Okay? How many times are we crucifying him all over again by how we compartmentalize our lives? Yes, I pray for people, but this is different. Yes, I sing hymns on this day, but these are the things that I'm a part of on Friday. This is my Sunday life. This is my Friday life. What he is saying is this cannot be. Jesus doesn't live in church. He lives in you. And where you go, he goes, right? Where he leads is where we're supposed to go. Instead of us dragging him where we want, hoping that he will not see the things that we're doing. Man, one of the things that we should pray for today, that I'm praying for today, is, Lord, show me the little compartments that I've hidden away. Show me the little areas that, although I'm feeling really good about this part of my life, this is the part that I can't let go of. Yes, I want to trust you, but no, I cannot forgive her. Yes, I want to go anywhere. I want to serve you, but no, I cannot let my child go on a mission trip. I'll have faith for you, but this is my wife, and that's different. There's so many places that we've got these big lines still drawn, and we're not seeing it. And it's as though James just walked up into this church and just yanked all the drawers out on the table and said, this is us. We have to deal with truth. Try to imagine. This is a letter, right? So James wrote this letter, and this letter gets served up to this church, and they're all getting together Sunday, and they're all going, hey, it's a letter from James. Come on, kids, let's all sit down. So they sit down, they start reading this letter, and it started out great. Guys, you've had a hard time in life. It's okay. God's gonna give you comfort. He's gonna give you his joy. Oh, that's the thing. I'm so glad. I need some joy. Lord, I'm gonna give you this part of my life because I need some joy where I'm hurting. This is my storm, and I'm gonna praise you in this storm, and thank you so much for that. Well, you know what? God also wants to give you wisdom. Oh, Lord, thank you so much. I need some wisdom because I've got all these decisions that I need to make. Let me give you all these decisions. Help me, Lord, in making these decisions. Man, this is good stuff. It's a good letter. Then he starts saying, be careful how you use your tongue. We need to be quick to listen and slow to speak. Suddenly, the amens get a little quieter, right? He starts getting into some of these other areas, and people are starting to get really, really quiet and really uncomfortable. What we've got to see is Jesus owns me. I have no rights. What am I holding back from him? What is it that I'm scared to death to let him have? That's our question, I believe he's trying to ask us today. God bless you guys. Tomorrow we're going to get into, we're going to get into a good one. Verse 14, this is everybody's little pet right here. Everybody likes to fuss about this. So let's fuss about it together. Love you guys. Take care.